It's time for a Fan Mogul Moment.
Hi, I'm John Farris with Fan Moguls at Dragon Con 2014 with Project IRadio. Guys, thank you for joining us.
Yeah, our pleasure.
Glad to be here.
Let's jump right in. Go ahead and introduce yourselves, guys.
I'm Jess Roberts. I'm the founder of Project IRadio. I also co-host two shows on Project IRadio, Nerdvana, which we handle celebrity interviews, and Jim will tell more about that one. And then also Respawn, which is a gaming, video gaming related podcast I co-host with Stefano, my buddy here beside me, and also Michael. And that's my background in Project IRadio. I handle all the marketing, the web design side of it, the actual promotional side of it. And
now, how long, Jess, have you guys been in operation?
We launched April 1st was our actual launch day. So April Fool's Day, it's a big joke, we launched, and here we are.
That's awesome. And sitting to your right.
I'm Stefano Echanique. I co-host Respawn Radio with Jess, also help out with art assets. Just talk about video games and nerd stuff, I guess.
Nerd stuff. Define nerd stuff.
What movies, shows. I mean, we talk about just about anything. Mostly video games, of course, but, you know, we're like a group of guys just hanging out, drinking whiskey, and talking about random stuff.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Lots
and, of random. And who is this to your right?
I'm not sure. Oh, yes, I'm Jim Adams. I host Nerdvana. Jess is the young nerd on the show. I'm the old nerd. So we discuss on a lot of the issues we discuss. We take it from two different perspectives. I go back farther than I'd care to admit. But nerds over the decades have really not changed much. And then in some ways they have. We got more technology, more gaming. I'm getting educated on that. I'm educating guys like Jess on sort of some of the old nerd fun stuff we had as far as TV, early TV films. The big independent film craze of the 70s, how horror has changed over the years, sci-fi dramatically changed, that sort of thing.
Since I'm a young guy, give us some old school nerd stuff.
Old school nerd stuff. I go back, like as far back, I wasn't alive then, but the old 40s Universal horror films.
Yes, he was.
Yeah. Frankenstein, Dracula, The Mummy, Wolfman. I probably relate more to the 50s sci-fi craze when you had the big bugs like them, giant mantises, some of the crazy sci-fi, some of the real cheesy sci-fi stuff of how a spaceship going to the moon makes a wrong turn and ends up on Mars, you know, things of that nature. But for us as kids, it's a lot of fun. Loved the old serials, like the old Flash Gordon serials, Superman, The Adventures of Superman TV show. I think most of the people from my generation grew up on the old George Reeves show, that sort of thing. Some of that fun stuff.
So you guys pair off each other really well then
on
the show.
Yeah,
they don't
absolutely.
Think they pair off me very well. They're trying to get rid of me right now, but you know, I just won't let them.
It's a great banter between us. It's not a point counterpoint type situation. We play well off each other, and it's our whole goal is to actually just have fun on the show and talk about issues and cons and, you know, things that there's not a lot of vehicles out there for people that are nerds and geeks that, you know, from a listening standpoint, that really talk about the topics the way we do. And like I said, we just try to make it sound like a conversation in your living room so you can have fun with it.
Now, speaking of cons, guys, yeah. I mean, look around us. I mean, this place is packed. Real quick, give us your con experiences. Tell us about Dragon Con.
Well, this was actually my first Dragon Con.
Yay!
So, yeah, I got the first one in the belt. Completely different than what I thought it would be. I've been to business cons my entire career growing up, you know, growing into business. I've been to plenty of business cons. MomoCon this year was my first fan con, and then now with Dragon Con, such a different experience. The people here have all just been extremely great. You know, everybody is like this whole sense of friendship and family that's around everywhere. Just sensory overload, just complete sensory overload.
Yeah, and this is my first con ever.
Ever?
Ever.
This is your first con
yeah,
ever?
Yeah, I'm getting my cherry popped.
Wow. Can we say that? Yes, I guess we can. Without censorship? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. But anyway, so this is overwhelming. This is overwhelming for you then.
Yeah, man. I mean, I was lost. I have no idea what's going on. I still don't know what's going on. But it's been fun, man. I mean, just seeing all the people that really, really, really get into it. It's amazing. I love it. it's good stuff. Like, it's definitely a culture shock, for sure.
Now, you're from Atlanta.
Yeah, well, north of Atlanta, yes.
North of Atlanta, like I am, okay.
Right, right.
All right, so yeah, you come down here and you have people from all over the U.S. coming to the con, and costumes and cosplay and conventions and stuff, and so it's a lot to take in.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't realize how, like, serious people took this stuff. I mean, you got people that, like, have their poses down to a T. Like, oh man, they make like their suits out of like crazy materials that look almost like metal. I mean, it's insane.
now, since you have the mic in your hand, I always love to ask this question at conventions.
Right.
What has been the most outstanding costume you've seen so far that made you sit back and go, wow?
I gotta say Groot, man. Like, we saw a Groot last night, and it was pretty awesome, I thought. Also, there's a Kratos. I'm a video game guy, so I saw Kratos, big buff guy. I mean, he got it down to a T. It was pretty awesome, I must say.
And Jim, what about you?
I go back on the cons a little bit. I had a little bit of a gap there for about 10 years from when I was a regular conner for the Dragon Con. So I went back for the first time in several years last year. So this is my second one in the last 2 years. I tended to gravitate towards a lot of the horror cons. So I'm really excited about the Monsterama Con that we helped with this year, because it was their first time out of the blocks. I used to hang out at Twisted Fears, some of the Walker Stalker stuff, the Walking Dead stuff. So I am probably a little more at home in the horror and sci-fi genre, coming back up to speed on the comic book genre, because frankly, after I got out of college, I got a little away from comics for a while. I mean, about the time Dark Knight was coming out, I was still heavy into it, and then there was a little gap in there. So I'm really getting educated on what has happened. A lot has happened in the gaming industry and comic books that I'm going to school on right now.
And same question posed to you. What costume has been the most outstanding?
Well, I gotta say, Stefano mentioned the Groot. Yeah, that really said, but there was a Hulk I saw as we were leaving last night, coming down one of the back stairwells, coming out of one of the, I think it was the Hyatt. The guy took up the whole stairwell. I mean, it was an incredible costume, and very real. I mean, you know, sometimes some of these pre-manufactured costumes don't look that real. This one, I don't know if he made it himself or whatever, but I mean, it was magnificent from where we were standing. So, getting quite a the Batman and Batgirl we saw last night. We shot some pictures of a friend of ours who, and I don't want to give away secret identity, but who was Batman. It was a very good costume. I thought very believable. So, yeah, there's been some amazing stuff.
And Jess?
You know, I'd have to agree with Stefano on the Kratos. That was a great one, because the guy was built anyway, full of muscle, but there are certain shadings that you have to do to make the definition stand out, and he had the shading to a T. And probably running in as almost a complete tie was a Warhammer costume.
Warhammer.
Where it was a full-blown suit of armor. The guy was, he couldn't sit here where we're at right now because the armor suit was so big. You know, the legs were about as wide as my torso, and to see somebody in that size piece of armor, walking around, and we got his card and got some pictures, but it's like, that to me was just amazing, the amount of time that it took them to make that costume, and they'd made it themselves. To make that costume, to have it functional like that to me was probably one of the best ones I saw.
And of course, you guys all saw the parade. Right, stayed for the parade, or some of you stayed for the parade? Did you catch the parade?
Caught some of the after effects of the parade.
Yes. The after effects. The swarm of 30,000 people trying to get up and down the street.
That's the after
effects.
I was at the parade last year, and this year's, from the videos I've seen, my God. I mean, it's magnificent. I mean, I'm always stunned at the size of the parades every year. They've grown bigger and bigger and bigger. The costumes become more ornate. Some of the props that come along with the costumes are made. You know, I mean, now last night we were leaving, I won't say how late, but fairly late last night, and the Ghostbusters vehicle came flying down Cortland Avenue. And I mean, it was dead on. I mean, it was, I was wondering where the call was going to. I mean, it was amazing. So it never ceases to amaze me, the dedication and the commitment that the cosplayers and the fans have when they come to cons like this.
And that's been, like, my biggest shock is how, like,
serious all these people like take this stuff. I mean, like, you know, I was expecting people in costumes, you know, kind of being silly and not really taking, I mean, just being goofy. But now, I mean, like, these people take it like hardcore to the max. I mean, like, I wasn't expecting to see a Ghostbusters car. I mean, that was amazing. I was like, holy, what? It was pretty awesome. I gotta say, I've seen a lot of awesome stuff. So.
And probably one of the most impressive things, like I said, the costumes that you recognize, the Kratos, the Warhammers, like the costumes you recognize, those are awesome. But the opportunity we had to actually talk to some of these people that were fans that had created their own characters, that to me is even better, because it's like the same amount of effort goes into making those costumes, but then an extra amount goes in, because when you talk to these guys, they have the full backstory of the character. They have the history, they have, you know, my weapon's named after past lovers, and this is Velma, and Velma was, you know, she was a great, you know, great person, but she left me, and you know, and it's just like the complete story for that character. And it's a blend of Han Solo versus Indiana Jones, and meets this, and it's like to get those stories and to see how much effort they put into it, and it's just one of many characters that they're bringing out that weekend. That to me is a level, you know, like Stefano was saying, the amount of seriousness that these people are taking on. To me, it's like the time and effort and dedication it comes to create a character and then become that character, there's just no way to put it that other than saying it's like that is a true fan of the art.
Yeah, I don't know if you had a chance to see the Captain Jack Sparrow Stormtrooper that was walking around.
I did.
But he was awesome, so I'm with you on that. One last question, guys, because I know you got to go, and I want you to, you know, get a chance to take in more of the con experience. Project IRadio. What's coming up on Project IRadio? What can fans look forward to, and how can they find you and all that?
Well, like I said, we have a couple of different originally produced shows on Project IRadio. One is Film Tracks, which is original motion picture scores that are put together. So we have a sword and medieval arts one coming up. We have a old cowboys one coming up. We have John Barry just recently aired. That's one show that's going from Project IRadio, from Nerdvana. Jim, I'll let you talk about the interviews coming up on Nerdvana.
I can remember them all, yeah.
and then Respawn, you know, from a gaming perspective, we've gotten the opportunity to talk to Damian Clark, who was Handsome Jack in Borderlands. We had Dan Jolly on from Dying Light, the actual story writer of Dying Light. He was on with us a couple of weeks ago. So that's kind of from, we've got a lot of guests coming up. And like I said, I'll let Jim talk to about some of the ones on Nerdvana.
All right, cool. Thank you.
Right. And sometimes we will spill over a little bit with some of the, we've had a lot of gamers, a lot of the gaming people like Courtney Draper, and others on Nerdvana. I tend to gravitate more towards some of the film folks, film and television folks. Jed Brophy, who's here this weekend from The Hobbit, has been a guest on our show. Mark Ryan, who's in Transformers and Black Sails. And we're always looking for personalities on Nerdvana interviews that are in what I call the nerd-oriented type shows. We've got requests in for the cast of Arrow, the new cast of Flash. You know, maybe somebody from Smallville will see this. I'm a huge Smallville fan. I really like to someday hope to get some of their cast members on. And going back to some of the classic television and films, we had Suze Lanier Bramlett, who was in the original Hills Have Eyes, and folks like that. We had Deborah Reed, who was in the worst motion picture ever made in the history of motion pictures, Troll 2. She was the Troll Queen. And now that I mentioned Troll Queen, everybody knows who I'm talking about. A real sweetheart. So we've been able to have some really amazing people throughout the decades who have been in this industry. And, you know, just trying to show our audience that these are real people. They're really, really good people and who love what they do and are committed to what they do. And, you know, and hopefully we can bring them into your living room, your car, wherever you're listening to us, and really have fun with it.
And some of the upcoming interviews that we have lined up that are coming up, Tonya Brown will be coming up in the next week or so. Hendon Walsh, who, if you're a fan of Teen Titans, you'll recognize her as Spitfire from Teen Titans. Jonathan Mayberry, we've actually got a chance to meet Jonathan here at the con, and we've got him set up. We're going to be setting up an interview with him as well. Let's see, who else do we have coming up?
Well, you know, one thing that has opened up for us that we never anticipated when we started Project IRadio is some of the newer up-and-coming artists, not just actors. We've got a couple of young songwriters and musicians out of L.A. Trev right now, a guy, a kid by the name of Trev, who's really starting to make some waves out on the music scene. We've got a kid, David, who's going to be in the new Step Up film as a singer, dancer, and actor. And that's been one of the little perks that we never anticipated, that they'd come to us and said, you know, would you like to talk to, and when we're talking with Anya Martin, the sci-fi writer, the horror writer yesterday, we're arranging to have some of the upcoming writers, some of the upcoming horror writers that are just now getting published and not quite well known, but really have some good stuff out there. And we love being able to do that, to talk to people that are just on the beginnings of their careers.
Really.
And with World Horror Con coming up here in the Atlanta market, the 25th anniversary for that's coming up here. We had a great opportunity, John Farris, which you might know.
I heard that guy.
It
rings a bell.
Yeah, you might know.
He speaks of you.
Does he?
Yeah.
I hope he speaks well.
He speaks of
he
you.
He speaks
oh.
of you.
Oh, he speaks
yeah.
of me. Okay.
But no, we actually had an interview with John Farris a couple of weeks ago, which you can still find our past interviews on ProjectIRadio.com, okay. And also on iTunes and Stitcher. They're all available there as well. We had an opportunity, a great interview. It was a very fun interview with John. We actually got to spend some time with him there in his home, which was just wonderful. And that's opened up other opportunities as well. And like I said, from a writer's perspective, with World Horror Con coming up, a lot of the writers that we've talked to are used to getting written interviews. You know, they'll do an interview on paper. The interview for a podcast or for a streaming online radio station or for anything audio is kind of new to them, and it's breaking them out of the shell. With John actually being on, that has opened up some doors of people saying, oh, okay, well, yeah, we might like doing
right.
that. You know, because not everybody's a Jonathan Mayberry that's like, oh, interview on podcast? Yes.
Right.
You know, not everybody is like that. So it's nice
true.
To actually see that that opening up some new avenues for people that are published, that are trying to get the word out there to get to where the listeners are.
Well, that's great. Guys, I really appreciate you sitting down with Fan Moguls, spending the time with us, sharing about Project iRadio, what's coming up, and the whole con. And there's just so much to see. If 4 days, it probably doesn't, you know, I mean, it's you can plan it out, but you're still going to miss something.
Right.
So, but I appreciate you guys being here. So thank
you
guys
very
much.
Thank you. Thanks so much, John.
Yeah. Absolutely. We look forward to hearing from you guys.
Thanks a lot.
This is John Farris signing off with Fan Moguls at Dragon Con. Thank you for tuning in.
Join our army of loyal fans on Facebook. Stay up to date with the latest news and like us. And if you love Twitter, we've got some tweets for you.